Hey, welcome to Flite Test. I'm Josh, and today we're going to be showing you how to build version 2 of a VersaCopter. Now, I got to sincerely thank everyone that helped us with version 1, all the feedback, and unfortunately some of our failures, but the great solutions you guys brought have brought version 2 out, and we're really excited to reveal it to you. One of the benefits you're going to see over version 1 is that we're now using CNC'd aluminum parts instead of G10 and Delrin. The only Delrin you're going to see here is aesthetic and to hold things like ESCs in place. We're also excited that the durability factor has gone up immensely. Along with the CNC'd parts, we also have different colors. Anodized aluminum comes in many different colors. We're going to have those available in the store. The stock kit comes all black, but for a few extra bucks, you can select your color, mix and match them, and help you with orientation or making it look like your own. Some final changes we made to the VersaCopter because of your feedback is we included extra battery straps, and we also moved more of the gear to the back. So in case you're flying with a different setup, you don't have to worry about the battery not giving you the proper CG. So today we're going to be building this with our Power Pack E and the ESCs that are included, and we're also going to be using the MZ12 Graupner all-in-one package that contains the GR18. Let's go ahead and get our materials in order and we'll get started. In this portion of the video, we're going to be showing you how to prepare your wire leads on your ESCs, pre-solder both the wire leads and the pads, and also prepare your power lead and the grommet that needs to be installed. The first step before soldering your ESCs, if you have the E-pack, is to go ahead and remove the XT30s from it. Just cut those off, leave as much of the length as you possibly can. Do this on all four ESCs. Before we solder the ESCs to the power distribution board, we're going to go ahead and tin the solder pads. In this case, we're going to use ESC 1, 2, 3, and 4. Pre-tinning those will help the ESC wires melt into the wire quicker and give you a better solder joint. Along with tinning the pads on the power distribution board, we're also going to tin the pads on the wire. Now, if you guys have any questions about how to properly solder, go ahead and watch our quick tips on soldering. Practice on a couple pieces of extra length of wire. It'll really help you. Do this on all four ESCs. Now, a real easy trick because it's hard to use helping hands and holders for a PCB board and hold the wire at the same time. Trick I like to do is I like to use a little popsicle stick or a little piece of wood to hold the wire down while you press it into place. Do this on all four ESCs, keeping in mind that the positive and negative are going to be the opposite on each side of each other. After you soldered all four, make sure you give them a good yank test to make sure nothing's broken. If any of the solder joints look questionable, go back and redo them again. Using the same process as before, go ahead and tin the main power distribution wires where your battery lead is going to go. This is going to take a lot more solder than the ESC wires. Now, before we install our power lead, we're going to go ahead and install this grommet. Now, personally, I think this is probably the hardest step in the whole entire build. We're going to go ahead and pass this through one, and then kind of get as much space as possible on the other side as we can. It's going to be very, very tight. Once you get it through, just grab it with the lead with a piece of pliers and pull it on. Go ahead and pull that grommet all the way up to where your heat shrink is. What this grommet is going to do is provide a nice little support that's going to go on our little back plate on our new style VersaCopter. Along with the soldering pads, we're going to tin the edges of our wire leads for our battery. I removed the tips of the pre-soldered leads here just so we can apply our own solder. Different companies and different manufacturers use different solder. You always want to use the same solder throughout your build. So I'm going to wind these nice and tight, take away all the air gaps, and then I'm pre-solder just like we did with our ESCs. I'll go ahead and put this over the power distribution board just so you can see it. I'm going to be doing this version 2 a little bit different than version 1 of the VersaCopter. I'm going to be routing the battery lead out the back end and also to the left or to the right. It totally is up to you on how you want to do it, but going out the back where it'll connect with the battery in the back. This will give you the ability to adjust the battery more from CG. That was a feedback we got a lot. Once you let it cool down, give it a good tug and inspect it very closely to make sure you're happy with your solder joints and they're connected. In this portion of the build, we're going to be showing you how to insert the bolts, the bottom taps, the boom clamps, the side plates, the battery straps, and how to get everything dressed up and zip tied. Now, to prepare the pieces that we need for our side plates, we're going to go ahead and remove the Delrin pieces. The nice thing about this version 2 compared to version 1 is we're only using Delrin for things that either hold ESCs or aesthetic things, not for anything structural anymore. Pop out the little pieces in the center. These are going to push down over the bolts in a friction fit so they won't fall off later. Just make sure you don't throw away these center pieces. Now, you're going to have extra, so make sure you hold on to those. We're going to install a 30mm screw through the bottom end pointing up just like this. Using the little tiny clips that we have provided, the hole is actually a slight oval. And we're going to go ahead and you should be able to just pressure fit this right over, and it's going to kind of glide down. On our next step, we're going to install our C-clamps. For this build, we're going to be using our red clamps just so you can see them a little bit more clearly. We're going to pass this through so the bolt passes through the larger opening of the C-clamp first and then engages the threads on the other side of the C-clamp. We're going to go ahead and spin this down until it just touches our bottom tab. We're going to go back through and we're going to tighten it just enough so everything stays nice and still and the widest end of the tab is touching the outer edge of the distribution plate. To prepare our side plates, we're going to go ahead and press in on each side two of these tabs, just like so. With your side plates assembled, go ahead and notch it into the tabs on the bottom of the plate. From that point, we can pass another 30mm screw through the bottom of the plate, engaging the holes in the side tabs. These are going to be slightly smaller than they're going to thread, so just go ahead and spin them on by hand. Once they get tight, finish the job with a screwdriver. These are button nose, and they're 2mm. You don't need to over-tighten this, just get it just slightly snug. Make sure that there's no gap between the little tabs and your side plate. We're going to repeat the exact same process on the other side. Insert the top tabs right over top and let it engage the side plates. These will friction fit and engage, and as we tighten the booms down, they'll seat even further into the side plates. Once your side plates are securely fastened, our next step is to route the ESC wires through the little tiny hole on the side just behind the boom clamps. Go ahead and do that on all four of your ESCs. Now on our E-pack, all the bullets and everything comes pre-soldered. If you're working on something like a different ESC brand, you may have to solder your bullet connectors on. We're going to take our black zip ties included in the kit, and we're going to pass it through the notch that's just behind the oval plate. We're going to keep the little knuckle on the very top because I want this part to be inside the plate. Let it loosely engage. Now before fully tightening, I'm going to slide this up just to give myself a little bit of airflow and relief on the back end here. Now I'm going to take this little knuckle of the zip tie, I'm going to slide it as far down as I possibly can, and then just a little bit of up pressure, we'll tighten it down. It doesn't have to be super tight, just snug. Take your side cuts and cut it off, and then you can push it the rest of the way down with your thumb. If you're utilizing something like a NAS 32 board or a Lux board, and you need to access the USB through the side plate here, there's a little tiny hole that you'll see right here. This is so you can mount your ESCs flat and pass a zip tie through that hole and keep everything flat and away, and that way your board can access through the side. For our build with the GR18, I'm going to go ahead and mount this nice and flat because the GR18 is both the receiver and the control board all in one. We're going to go ahead and use zip ties and tighten down all four ESCs. For the battery straps, we're going to line up the battery just like this. So the little flight test end is pointing to our right, and we're going to feed it face up down through one slot. So we installed our battery straps, and in this case, I left it below the lead here, but I covered the leads here. This works really well to insulate the leads, so if God forbid anything metal touches, the straps will cover it. In this step, we're going to show you how to install the booms, center them, and tighten them. Make sure that your boom clamps are so tight that the boom doesn't pass nicely through it. With a little bit of a twisting motion and a little bit of pressure, the boom slides right through. Go ahead and get both your top and your bottom booms slid through. And if you need to loosen a couple turns, that's just fine. Now would be a good time to take a ruler. And our measurement is going to be about 3 7/8. Just make sure that your boom on both sides have the identical measurement. Once we're happy with that, we're simply going to take our 2mm screwdriver and tighten it down. Now the nice thing about this design compared to version 1 was even if you have to open this up and take care of it, nothing gets turned loose. You don't have to recenter all your motors and recenter your booms every step. You're also going to notice once you tighten these down, the little top tabs that you inserted in the previous step are going to fully engage the side plates. In this portion of the build, we're going to show you how to add the motor mount boom clamps to the motors, install the motors, and make your connections. We're also going to show you how to mount the rear mounting plate for the wire lead and your SMA extension. Now, to fasten our motor mounts to our motors, we're going to use the 19mm spaced holes. This is 16mm, the shorter one, and the longer one is 19mm. We're going to want to use a 19 because that's going to be the size that's going to fit over our 9/16 inch boom. So we're going to lay this over. We're going to take the next one. We're going to hold that right over top of it. We're going to pass the screw. Now, this is a 25mm screw. Please be careful in the kits not to grab a 30mm. If you grab a 30mm and pass it through, it's going to hit the windings on the top and damage it. If you're using a high-performance, low-profile, keep that in mind. You may have to put a spacer in the very bottom to not let these go through, or order a shorter screw. Most of the motors out there work just fine. It's only the very high-advanced, low-profile motors that you got to be careful of. We're going to pass this through. Just give it a couple threads on each side. And we're going to do that step for all four of them. Once our clamps are installed on our motors, go ahead and slide it in. Now, I'm going to make careful notice. I'm going to have my leads point towards the body of the quadcopter. We don't want to point it now because if we tumble it, this could get damaged. So whether it's pointing towards inward or towards outward, that's okay. It can wrap around. It's going to be a lot more protected than if it's pointing like this. Now, we don't need to over-tighten this. We're just going to get it nice and snug, because at the very last steps, we're going to go ahead and level this off using our table. When we tighten this down, we're just going to go ahead and equally tighten on both sides so it doesn't over-pinch on the other. Keep in mind, if you're using motors other than our 2204, if you're using something like a high-performance, low-profile motor, make sure that your bolts are not going to pass through and hurt your coils. If you have to, go to a smaller bolt or use a spacer. Now would be an excellent time to go ahead and make our connections. Go ahead and fasten this down. And don't worry about zip tying this quite yet. We're going to make sure our motors are going the right direction before we fasten it down. In your kit, you're going to see this optional tab. Now, it's your choice if you want to use it. But what this portion is here is to be able to engage the grommet that we installed earlier in the build. This other portions here are for the zip ties included to be able to help route your antennas, whether you have two antennas for diversity or a single antenna. The far end here is for your SMA connector to pass through if you want to use an SMA extension to take the wear and tear off of your transmitter. To assemble and mount the rear plate, we're not going to be using the two extra included screws in the kit. We're actually going to use two of our short little stubby motor mount screws that we find in our e-pack. Oftentimes when you get a motor, you also get screws for mounting. These are 4mm screws, and I'd rather save the weight than passing them all the way through and using bolts on the other end. You're going to notice that these are also a little bit smaller than they need to be. That way, this acts as a nut and it tightens down. So to prep this area, I'm going to go ahead and take this lead. I'm going to move it all the way over to my right, as far as I can, like this. To insert the grommet, we're going to push it in at 90 degrees, and as it gets towards the edge, we're just going to rotate it and the rubber will engage. Once we're happy with that, we can go ahead and slide this up and then press it in, lining up the holes. With the holes lined up, we can start threading our first screw, and this is a 2.5mm screw. If you have our e-pack, there's also in the motor case an extra Allen wrench in case you don't have a 2.5mm screwdriver. To add a little bit of durability to our FPV system, I'm going to go ahead and use this SMA extension here. I'm going to take off this nut, and I'm going to pass it through the bottom here. This is going to take any kind of stress away from the video transmitter and put it on this holder and this extension. It's going to make your video transmitter last a lot longer, but make sure you remember to plug in the antenna before powering it all on. I'm going to go ahead and pass the SMA extension right through this piece right here. I'm going to mount the video transmitter on the side just so it gets a little bit more airflow. In this portion of the build, we're going to cover mounting our receiver, hooking up the ESCs to the receiver in their proper location, and routing the wires. We're also going to route the wires out the rear of the frame for the diversity antennas and fasten them to the zip ties. For this build, we're going to be using the Groppner GR18. This is an all-in-one control board and a receiver, so you don't have any boards to program. It's all done through the telemetry link. Now, if you're new to the hobby or you're looking to get into a new brand, the Groppner sells an all-in-one GR18 coupled with an MZ12 for a very economical price. Now, not all control boards are the same, so when we mount our receiver and control board all in one, we're going to want to go ahead and look at our manual. So right now, if you're using the GR18 with the 3-axis gyro in it, you're going to see a diagram. And basically, that diagram goes clockwise. So the top left is 1, the top right is 2, The bottom right is 3, and the bottom left is 4. So 1, 2, 3, 4. Now, if I flip this over and do the same logic, I'm going to be backwards. So what a good idea to do is to hang it up the exact orientation you're going to see it. Take the top left one and plug it into 1. Now, when I plug it, every receiver is a little bit different. So keep in mind to always check your manual to make sure it's appropriate. But in this case, the ground is going to be at the very, very bottom and the signal wires at the top. The way we can tell this is the negative is on the bottom. So if you take number 1 and you look at it, you're going to see the negative at the bottom. It's basically telling us our wires are going to be orientated like this. And then we take that logic and we cross it over into our number 1 port. You'll never see a receiver where it switches where the ground is. So since the ground is on the bottom of this one, you're going to have all your signal wires going across the top. Let's go ahead and go to the top right. There's number 2. Now the bottom right, number 3, and the last one is the bottom left, and that's number 4. So once again, all our signal wires on this model are on the top, all our ground is in the bottom. We're using ports 1, 2, 3, 4, but not 5 or 6. So for mounting the GR18, I want to be able to access our little bind button. Normally when you get this out of the box, especially if you get the combo and you bind it to a Groppner radio, if you mount it with the antennas pointing forward and face up, which in this case would be label facing up to the sky, you wouldn't have to do any changes other than your ESC calibration. But in this case, I want diversity going out the back, and I want to use the holders that we included in the kit. So we're going to go through an extra step of calibration, but it's very good for you to know it, because if you ever change configurations on this model, you're going to want to utilize that method. So in this case, we're going to mount it this way. You're going to notice that these two guys engage the tabs, and when I flip it over, you're going to notice that the bind plug is easily accessible. Now with the receiver gyro combo loosely snapped in place, I'm going to go ahead and gather these wires up and kind of bunch them up like a ponytail. I want to go ahead and dress up this area, so I'm going to take a zip tie and zip tie it together. This airframe has a lot of real estate. You just want to stay organized and keep it nice and clean. Don't go too tight with it. Just enough to hold it in place. Now I can fold this over, and I can slide it right down the side, giving me two nice, very large open cavities for any other electronics, gear, or optional FPV lineouts that I may need. Now for routing these rear antennas, it's oftentimes a good idea to have the antennas spreading apart at a 90 degree angle or as close as possible and swept back, so when you're flying forward, the antennas are as predominant as possible, but also oriented away from each other so you get the best diversity as possible. To do this, we're going to take these larger zip ties included in the kit, and we're going to pass them through. Once we pass them through, we don't need the whole entire length, so we're going to cut them to the size of the antenna that we need. Just get them all snug, like that. Go ahead and do that on both sides. Now, if you only have one antenna, you can use the slot in the middle. I'm just going to give a little tug and angle them away from each other, just like that. For our next step, we're going to go ahead and round our antenna leads down around the boom and up through the top. Doesn't matter which side you go on the boom, I'm going to go on the bottom in this case. I'm going to pass the leads through the little oval. And here's where I can cut this to dimensions. I'm going to make this just a little bit longer than it needs to be. I'm going to make sure I definitely remove my antenna before I cut it the length. Now you have two different options. You can just use a little bit of tape, or you can cut some heat shrink tubing and slide it over. The heat shrink tubing does a really great job on protecting the antennas and keeping them attached to their supports. If you don't have any heat shrink tubing, Scotch tape works just as well. In this portion of the build, we're gonna go ahead and calibrate our receiver, go through the settings on our transmitter to make sure all the motors run in the proper direction and the gyros are responding properly. We're also gonna go ahead and route and clean up all of our loose wires once we're happy with the direction and the operation of the motors. Now, if you're gonna build a lot of multi-rotors, I'd strongly recommend that you invest in a DVOM or a digital volt ohm meter. These things can be as cheap as $5 or go up to 100. You don't really need a really high-tech one, but what we do wanna do is make sure we don't have any shorts. Easiest way to tell is if we touch red and black, we should not hear anything. But if we touch red to red, we have continuity. This area here is if we're going to be using any optional equipment that requires voltage to either be stepped down or to be stepped up in very rare cases. This is a Pololu circuit. And this can be bought by getfpv.com. By soldering a Pololu circuit in here, we can regulate this to whatever we want. Typically, it's going to be 5 volts or 12 volts. Oftentimes, we'll use this to power video transmitters and cameras. Unless you have this Pololu circuit soldered, you're not going to get any source voltage. If you have the Graupner combo, where the radio transmitter and the radio receiver come in the same box, they're already going to be pre-bound. But if you already have something like an MZ24, an MZ18, or even an MZ12 and you just purchased a GR18 separately, I'm going to go ahead and show you how to do that. Now keep in mind, we're going to have additional videos showing you how to do things like NAS32 boards and even the Lux in the near future. So check those video links out if that's the equipment you're using. With this powered on, I'm going to go ahead and select, and I'm going to go ahead and go down to RF settings. You're going to see your directional pad on the left and your enter and all your other features on the right. Once we're on RF settings, I'm going to hit enter. I'm going to make sure that our stick mode is set to 2, that's mode 2. And I'm going to scroll down to receiver bind. Now this is already bound. Normally it would be blank there. But what I'm going to do is I'm going to go ahead and plug this in. So I'm going to go ahead and press down on this little button here. And it's going to be hard to see on the camera, but a little tiny green LED will light up next to it. Once it lights up, I'm going to hit enter. Once it successfully binds, the LED will turn all green. Now from this point on, I can go ahead and see if my motors run. And they do. So at this point, we're ready to do some calibrations. So for these calibrations, I'm going to go ahead and turn it so it's orientated the proper way for you nice folks. With the machine powered on and your transmitter, and you have a successful link, I'm going to hit the telemetry button. The first option is going to be setting and data view. I'm going to hit enter. And from this, I can go ahead and view and change my PIDs. I can set alarm settings. It's a very powerful radio. I'm going to scroll over until I find the page where I find the word mode. From that point, I'm going to scroll down. I'm going to hit enter in highlight mode. And I'm going to go ahead and scroll and make it say ESC set. And then I'm going to hit enter one more time. Now, I can't stress enough, don't ever have your props on during any of these steps, no matter what control board you have. Now that my transmitter is in ESC mode, I'm going to go ahead and power down both the machine and the transmitter. Now I'm going to power on the transmitter first, let it boot, and then raise the throttle all the way to the highest limit. After I do that, I'm going to go ahead and plug in my machine. Once you hear two beeps, decrease all the way to the bottom. At this point, we should be able to start all four motors simultaneously. Just like that. Now the important thing is before we go any further, let's go back and change it out of ESC mode into normal mode. So I'm going to hit telemetry. I'm going to hit enter on system data. So I'm going to scroll over until I see mode again. I'm going to scroll down. I'm going to hit enter. I'm going to hit the up button. Now I'm going to hit enter one more time. From this point, I'm going to go ahead and power down again both the transmitter and the machine. All right, we're going to go ahead and power the machine on one more time. And the transmitter too. It's going to boot up. All right, that works wonderfully. Now let's go ahead and do a couple key functions here that we're going to want to do to calibrate it. Mainly because I turn the antennas pointing backwards, I want the machine to learn what the new pitch directions are and what the new roll directions and yaw directions are. To do that, I'm going to go back into my telemetry menu. I'm going to hit enter. I'm going to scroll until I see a menu setting. This is gyro assignment. Now the really cool thing about this receiver is it learns. In this case, I'm going to go ahead and enter into this mode, and I'm going to do a movement on my stick, and I'm going to turn the multirotor in the proper direction. When I do that, it's going to learn what gyros are being activated, and it's going to calibrate it. So you're going to notice plus 1, or plus 2, plus 1, and minus 3. Let's go ahead and see if that changes after I do this calibration. So I'm going to hit enter for do setup. I'm going to scroll up. I'm going to hit enter. Now, from this point, I'm going to go to my bank stick, or my roll, and I'm going to roll to the right. It's going to highlight that. Now I'm going to pick up my machine and I'm going to do a roll to the right. You're going to immediately notice that it went from positive 2 to negative 2. Now I'm going to pitch forward. And I'm going to go to my machine, keep the front onto the workbench, and I'm going to roll it forward. And once again, that one went to a negative one. My next step is yaw to the right. And now I'm going to spin this very slowly past 45 degrees to the right. Once I do this, all the gyros have now been assigned in their proper orientation and they're going to work properly. But we're always going to want to check that. So now that our gyros are calibrated, we don't want to take that for granted. We always want to go back and check it. Easy way to check that is we're going to listen for the RPM change whenever we make the machine react. So I'm going to go ahead and tape a little piece of tape onto the motor just so it kind of flaps around. We're also going to use the same method to make sure the motors are spinning in the right direction. Now I'm going to try to just give it just enough RPM, just like that. Now when I react to this, you're going to hear when I pitch this forward, the RPM increases. When I bank it, the RPM increases. And when I turn it to the left, the right RPM increases. This tells me that all the gyros are working properly. Now when we go out to test fly this, we're definitely going to make sure we're nice and clear. We're going to give it a little bit of throttle and we're going to wiggle our sticks. If it's set backwards, it's going to flop around like a fish. Make sure you always give yourself lots of room and that no one's around your machine whenever you test fly a multi-rotor. One last calibration we want to do is we want to tell the control board and the transmitter what level looks like for this machine. So make sure your workbench is nice and level and make sure that your receiver is firmly set at the very bottom here, that it's not crooked. We're going to go into our telemetry menu again, system and data view, and then we're going to scroll over until we see calibration position. Let's go ahead and scroll down until that little arrow is next to it. We're going to hit enter. We're going to scroll up and you're going to see it go yes, then right back to no. It's now taken a snapshot and looked at what level is. So now we're ready to move on. Our last step is to make sure that all the motors on the machine are running the proper direction. Now this is something you always want to check the manual on no matter what control board you're using. In this case, we want the props spinning in towards the nose and then back in towards the tail. So we're going to make sure our motors spin appropriately. I'm going to give it just a little bit of throttle. And I'm just going to go ahead and touch it and just kick my finger this way. That one's backwards. That one's right. That one's right. And that one's right. So the only one that we need to fix is this one right here. To fix it, we're going to take any two of these connectors. We're going to unplug them and we're going to swap them. Now when I power it up, instead of it running this way, it should run this way. And it does. So now we're going to go ahead and dress our wires. An easy way to dress our wires is I'm going to go ahead and carefully move a little screwdriver through here. I'm going to be able to work these wires back inside the machine. And I want the bolts to be exposed. Once I have this pulled back a little bit, I'm going to go ahead and snake my wire just so I have a little relief by the motor and zip tie it. So it's all a matter of preference. I like to put a zip tie close to the motor mount and a zip tie close to the main body, but I like to keep my bullets accessible in case I have to do any kind of repairs or reverse anything later. Once I'm happy with the fit, I'll stick the two ends. In a later video, we're gonna go ahead and cover installing FPV. So I'm gonna go ahead and zip tie this to the side just to get it out of the way for now. In this final stage of the build, we're gonna go ahead and install our props, install the bottom plate, make sure our motors are perpendicular to the frame, and go out and test fly it. So we're gonna go ahead and install our bottom plate. The only thing we wanna make sure is we wanna make sure that the triangle is pointing towards the back. There's two different sides. You can pick whichever one you like the most. In this case, I think I'm gonna go with the bigger logo. Making sure we're not pinching any wires. We'll firmly seat everything down. Also double check and make sure all your tabs are in place and still engaging your side plate. One thing I'm going to go ahead and install that's optional is this little camera holder here. I'm going to go ahead and slide this down in, and if you want to, you can put additional screws in the back, but you really don't need to. You have extra screws in the kit. Make sure if you pass it through that you just don't hit your wires for your ESCs. Now the nice thing compared from version 1 to version 2 is it used to be that we'd have to hold it on the other side for the boom clamps. We don't need to do that anymore because they're already tightened down. All we need to do is go ahead and tighten it on down. I'm going to go ahead and do the rear. I still like to put my finger on the bottom just to make sure nothing's moving. And the last two screws we are going to need to hold the back. Now, if you're looking to fly the VersaCopter FPV, we're going to have an updated video with the latest and greatest technology that we're going to go ahead and link to. With our bottom plate installed, we're going to go ahead and just slightly loosen up the two motors on the left side. Just a quarter of a turn, just enough to be able to move it by hand, like that. Now, we're going to go to the edge of a table, and not putting it on the bolts, but putting it on the actual flats, we're going to go ahead and move this so all the motors are flat up against the table. Once we're happy with that, we can go back and we can tighten this up. Make sure when you tighten this up that you can't move it by hand. Now, the beautiful thing about this is if you crack and God forbid you break a boom, all you need to do is loosen the screws. You shouldn't need to take anything apart unless you did damage to an ESC or a wire. We're going to do the exact same process on the other side. Now, one of the reasons why we call this VersaCopter is we want people to experiment with things like thrust angles, configuration, sizes. This is a really good platform. If you like to race a lot and you like forward swept motors, go ahead and put a little shim under the back of the motor and sweep them all forward. Now that all our motors are properly adjusted, we're going to go ahead and install our props now. Now this should be the first time that your machine is getting props, and the next time that we power it up, it's going to be outside for its maiden. So let's go ahead and orientate this where the numbers are facing up. And after checking the manual, the direction of the prop is going to go in towards the nose on both sides and then in towards the tail on both sides. So make sure that the raised edge of the prop is facing up and then it swings inward. Before installing the props, we're going to install the little precision bushing into the bottom of each one. Make sure you choose the bushing that snugly fits the shaft of your motor. Let's go ahead and loosely fasten all four motors. So this propeller here is going to spin inwards this direction. This propeller is going to swing this way. If you don't put these little precision bushings on, you're going to get a bad vibration. Once all your four props are orientated properly, so they spin in the right direction, go ahead and tighten them down. Now in our kits, all of our motors are going to have plus thread or counterclockwise thread, and they're also going to include four lock nuts. Those four lock nuts are going to be able to be used in case, God forbid, you lose one of these nuts. What we noticed in the past, we got a lot of feedback that the reverse threaded nuts, people were losing them, and it was very difficult for them to track down new ones. If you are missing reverse threaded nuts, we have both sizes available now for both the small motors and the large motors. Now with our props installed, the last step is to install our battery. We're not going to plug this in until we're outside, but the battery is also going to help us with our CG. So I'm going to pass this through and tighten it down. Because I have no GoPro or FPV gear, I'm going to go ahead and favor towards the middle. I'm going to tighten it down nice and solid. When I pick it up by the bolts, what I want to see is the VersaCopter balancing nice and level, just like that. All right, the only thing left to do is to go out and test fly it. All right, the VersaCopter is now ready for its maiden. We're going to be having an additional video showing NACE32, but also FPV as well. So if you guys need to put FPV or are working on a NACE32 board, check those videos out. They'll be linked down below. But now we're ready. In case you haven't noticed, I put a voltage alarm. If you ever get into multi-rotors, when you run out of voltage, your machine crashes. We don't want that. These are only $3. It's a good investment. So let's go ahead and put on a nice flat surface. We're going to power out our transmitter first, and then we're going to go ahead and initialize this. It's always a good idea to keep your distance the first time you test fly a multi-rotor. Make sure no one else is around it. Make sure you have a nice clear area to take it off from. All right, let's go ahead and power it up. There we are. Now I'm in horizon mode. If you want to go ahead and go to acro mode on the GR18, all you need to do is change channel 5 and toggle it. Even in this windy weather, it handles really nice. One thing we've noticed with the CNC parts, it's a lot more rigid and it feels a lot more solid going through the air. So if you're just learning, horizon mode is a great place to start. I'm going to go ahead and put it down, and I'm going to go ahead and activate acro. To do that, I'm going to go into my control settings. I'm going to go to I6, I'm going to hit enter, and I'm going to go ahead and activate it to this switch here. Just by doing that, I'll be able to go from horizon to acro mode. So you can see right now, I'm an auto level, now I'm an acro. This is the preferred mode you want to be in whenever you're racing. As you get more comfortable, you can dial up the settings. You don't need to go to a computer. All you need to do is go to your transmitter and increase the rate. Flies real nice. Friends, I want to thank you for watching. Thank you so much for the feedback that you gave us in version one of the VersaCopter. Now, the plates haven't changed at all, but the fittings have. And we're going to take what we learned and we're going to apply that to all the future configurations, sizes, and builds that we have in the future. Please keep the suggestions coming. And then whenever we fail, we always want to make it right. We always look to the community to help us do so. We'll see you next time.